kind of like a cross between Napoleon and Diaghilev. He had Napoleon's presence and energy and power, and he had this imagination of Diaghilev, being able to see how things could be transformed.
Easy to work for, Mickey Seckers. That is one of the understatements of the century. He was not at all easy to work for. He was incredibly impulsive, generous to a fault, quixotic. He could be very naive about some things, but extraordinarily sophisticated about others. He was tyrannical, he was irrational, he was full of infinite charm, and he was an inspiration.
They all thought he was mad to open a theatre like this in the wilds of Cumbria in 1959, lined with silk and silk seats, and small.
He'd say, well, we must economise, we must economise. And then he'd send out for half a dozen bottles of champagne.
In my heart, I still miss him because he's one of the most remarkable people I ever met.
Was he really a gift from Hitler? Certainly, he would have rejected the label of refugee. Mickey was much too grand for that. He might just have been prepared to accept economic migrant. But there's no denying that it was Hitler who kept him here, just as the rise of fascism in the 30s had forced him to make Britain his home. And in return, his adopted country honoured him with a knighthood as Sir Nicholas Seckers.
The night that he was knighted, he came to a party just up the road at Mr. and Mrs. Coulthard's house, and he said, I've been knighted. And that really, really thrilled him.
But before he became Sir Nicholas, there was the problem of his surname.
He went to America, Seckers, S-Z-E-K-E-R-E-S, Seckers. That's what we knew him at the beginning. So the man said, the man in America said to him, what do they call you at home? He said, Mickey. Well, he said, that's fine, we call you Mickey. Mickey, now this other name, this Seckers thing here, let's cut that down a bit. So they cut it down to S-E-K-E-R-S. He said, you are Mickey Seckers.
New names, new country, new ways of living. These Hungarians who came to Cumberland to start the industries which were to replace the indigenous iron ore and coal seams brought with them the values, tastes and culture of Middle Europe. One of them, Frank Schon, later spoke of a significant encounter with Mickey.
Well, he said, it's like this, you see. Mickey, they all called him Mickey Seckers. Mickey comes in. He is wearing a scarlet jumper, dress trousers and carpet slippers. And he says, Frank, how do I look? And I said, Mickey, you look crazy. He said, I am crazy, Frank. I am going to turn my coach house into a theatre and you are going to give me £5,000. Oh, no, I am not, I said. But, you know, he said he would tell everyone I was a Philistine who did not love the arts. So what could I do? I waited 3 days and I capitulated. And that's the story of how Frank Schon gave £5,000 to the beginning of the theatre.
One of the most remarkable developments that have occurred in Cumberland since the war is the theatre at Rose Hill. There's scarcely a top artist in the international scene who hasn't visited this theatre and enormously enjoyed the experience. Now, how did this theatre, which has brought music and drama to a part of the world where it wasn't very often to be heard or seen live before, how did this theatre come into being?
First, I always want. Then, as you know, in Vikhavendon, it's a harbour. We had this delightful music hall. And one day, I noticed being pulled down. I bought the interior for very little, put it up in our stables. And I waited until I thought I'd get money to put it up there. And finally, we decided a good theatre, a good lecture, at a standard which is available in London, the big cities, or the festivals, Edinburgh, Bath, Oldborough. So I thought it would be very good if we bring art to the people, and the people have to travel to find it.
We'd been talking about this theatre for years and years and years. Meanwhile, he'd sold the idea to the whole of London. So having said he's going to build a theatre, finally started putting a gun to his head and say, well, Mickey, where is this theatre? Well, we want to come and see it. The interesting thing was that Whitehaven's more or less halfway between the Edinburgh Festival and London. So all the international stars who came to the Edinburgh Festival were kind of sidetracked to come to the theatre. So having invited them, some of the leading names in theatre and opera, to come to the theatre, again, he had to put it up.
If he said he was going to do something, it would be done. I remember the first time he hinted at building a theatre here. He was going to get John Gielgud here, he was going to get Rostropovich here, he going to get all these people here. But in that barn, Mickey, think of it, you're going to get 50 seats, 60 seats or something. Leave it to him, it would be done.
When we started to build, we already had to engage artists for a year ahead. And we planned a season, I think, for 36 performances. Had no idea if we can fill one performance with the audience. And it was a great financial risk too, because we haven't had the money yet.
They engaged some people here to a local architect and some workmen here to start work on what was to be convert the barn into a theatre.
And we went in with a tractor to do it. But as an old Georgian stable had no solid foundation, and during the night the whole building or part of it collapsed. So we had to start from the scratch, basically, and we had only a few months left for our opening date.
We had no theatre. So what should we do about that? Well, I said, I don't know what we can do, but I have a sister in Glasgow who works for a firm who is converting cinemas into bingo halls. Have them down. So I talked to my sister and she sent down a man from this firm. So this guy came down here and he's listened to Mickey was back by this time. And he said, look, you're crazy trying to make something out of an old barn. He says, you want to have at least a minimum 200 seats. Right. You must have a foyer for people to go in here and sort of meet and stuff here. You must have a bar. You must have two bars to make a thing play. So Mickey listened to this guy, and that's how the theatre was built.
I mean, it wasn't intended ever to be a pub-like atmosphere. It's meant to be a small, intimate jewel box of a theatre. The walls were rough, stone walls, so we strapped them out and covered them in silk from floor to ceiling, which sounds wonderful, but in fact it was a disaster, because Yehudi Menuhin came to play the violin, and the resonance from the silk wasn't sufficient for anyone to hear what he was playing, because the silk simply absorbed the sound. So we had to take it all down, cover all the walls in hardboard, yes, and then put up the silk until we got the right kind of sound. It wasn't that difficult, actually, because we had all the resources of the mill behind us. No difficulty getting fabric in the right colour at the right time. And it was just a cosmetic approach of putting up this kind of moulding and that kind of moulding until the whole thing came together.
I have a letter which is framed in my office from one of the industrialists who might ask financial support. He wrote to me he could afford it and he would do it, but he's not doing it because he doesn't want to encourage me, because anything in similar line ever started in Cumberland, it was a flop. And better if I realize it now, before I get involved.
But before the theatre, there was the mill. There would have been no Rosehill without the Cumberland silk mills.
They had this weaving plant making fabric, and they were immediately commandeered to make parachute silk, which was, they didn't have anything to worry about. No designing involved, no selling involved, no customers to worry about. Miles and miles of parachute silk made for the government. And that really started them off. And then, of course, when the war finished, they quickly adapted to making rather dressy fabrics, which no one had seen for 6 years.
Well, the point is that the French could do silk as well as we could, but then the people like the French always looked towards England, Britain, if you like, for wool fabrics. So what we decided to do was to use a very fine silk warp with a very fine wool weft, so we got almost transparent silk and wool fabrics. And Mickey went across there with his bag full of our fabrics, and Christian Dior himself said that when he heard there was an Englishman down there with fabrics that he might buy, he thought he'd have a good laugh. Anyway, when Mickey opened up his fabrics and showed them to him, he had something there.
One of my jobs in Paris was to look after the editoresses from all the fashion magazines from all over the world, like the editor of Vogue, editor of Harper's Bazaar. Mickey would give me a list in Paris and say, you have to go around, send all these wonderful ladies flowers. But if you were giving the editress of Vogue flowers, you don't give her a bunch of daffodils. You go to the best florist in Paris and you put together a huge bouquet for which you get a receipt. At that time, there was very strict currency control, so you had to account for all the money you'd spent. So my job also was to go back to the inspector of taxes in Whitehaven, show him all the receipts for these flowers, and I would be spending, like, in those days, £50 or £60 on flowers. And I had to explain this to a man who probably gave his wife a bunch of daffodils for her birthday.
The fashion writer for the Sunday Times in those days was Ernestine Carter. And once Ernestine Carter wrote in her Sunday column that she'd seen the Sackers collection this year, and if Sackers had more models in the couture collections this year than last year, she would eat her hat. And to that extent, she was running us down a bit. In the course of the week, Mickey discovered we had more models than ever before. So he went to Madame Floriston in London and had a great big marzipan hat made and sent it to Ernestine Carter. And in the next Sunday Times, here was the article by Ernestine Carter, worth thousands of pounds, to say that Sackers has had more models in the collection than ever before, and what's more, she was able to eat her hat. That's clever. Not paid publicity, that was publicity just got by cleverness.
But how on earth did he do it? How did he attract the greatest names in music and theatre, not to mention a sprinkling of royalty, to the least known part of the country? A few square miles of England's furthest coastline.
My friend and I were on holiday at the Aix-en-Provence Festival in the south of France. And Anthony, this is my friend, was working for the Workington Iron and Steel Company at the time and was a great habitué of this extraordinary place that he used to describe to me, which I didn't really believe. I mean, I didn't think that you would be getting, you know, these magical names in a tiny venue in somebody's garden in West Cumberland. But Anthony assured me that you did, and they did happen. And lo and behold, walking up the Cour Mirabeau was this extraordinary man. And Anthony said, "That's him. That's Mickey Sekers. Come on, go and say hello." So we did, and like everybody else, I suspect, whom we ever met, I fell instantly under the charm.
The way in which he was able to sort of, on the one hand, twist people's arms to come up here, and on the other hand, to interest them in the sort of life and energy that he emanated, and the way he acted as a host at Rose Hill House and had people like Yehudi Menuhin and other great artists coming to spend the weekend with him, with a concert on the Saturday night that was always packed.
They came for him. Because of him, they'd met him, they'd heard about the theatre and how lovely it was and what good acoustics it had. It had the best of everything. And they just was ill.
What he created at Rose Hill was high art. No concessions to popular taste and no dilution of standards. He believed that Cumbrians were entitled to expect the same standards of production and performance as the citizens of Budapest or Vienna. Adventurous concepts, like this Jonathan Miller version of Julius Caesar.
Oh, pardon me, thou bleeding piece of earth, that I am meek and gentle with these butchers.
Plays, classic, Lycomedes, avant-garde, so we try to fulfill a function of classical national theatre, a Western theatre, a place where they play jazz, or the festival hall.
Over thy wounds now do I prophesy, which like dumb mouths do ope their ruby lips to beg the voice and utterance of my tongue.
But I think we bring culture to anyone who is interested in culture, and as the situation is in Cumberland now, compared with the past, and I hope if we stay in the future, to come to Rose Hill, anyone could afford, from an errand boy to the chairman of an organization.
Mickey was not a snob in those ways. I just think he was interested in the kind of culture that he'd grown up in Budapest, you know, centered around the Liszt Academy and the theatre and the opera. Wanted it and liked it and tried it out and found that it was stimulating and couldn't live without it.
He may not have been a snob, but he had a distinct weakness for the royal family.
The day that the Queen Mother was coming in October 64, I think it was, he asked me about a quarter of an hour before she came to the theatre to go round and see if any light bulbs looked tired. I didn't really know how to, but I did. I went round and looked for them, just to keep him happy, because he was so stressed. He adored them in that they bought his materials from the silk mills. They had dresses. The Queen has had dresses made by silk from the mill.
He may have joined the ranks of the great and the good, as familiar on the lawns of Glyndebourne as he had once been along the boulevards of Budapest. But he was never quite at home with the English language.
He would lose words, and he'd get the wrong words coming out, but you still understood what he meant.
He once wrote a letter to a lady telling her she was the most suggestive person he knew. Well, of course, he meant that she gave him more ideas than anybody else.
There was a time in the 50s and 60s when Whitehaven was only known to the rest of the country through the personality of Mickey Seckers. The clothes he created, the artists he persuaded to come there, and the performances and productions that graced Rose Hill Theatre. All these were the stuff of countless gossip columns and reviews. But the truth is that Whitehaven never really took Mickey to its heart.
Whitehaven probably didn't take him to heart as much as they did with Frank Shaun and Mr. Marzillier, because they were industry and far bigger employers, put more money into their pockets. The silk mill was an elitist thing and not understood.
Not everybody in West Cumberland fell over in a dead faint if they heard that Victoria de Los Angeles was going to come and sing here. But there were enough people for whom this wasn't important. And they were not all necessarily county well-off people, not by any means. But, you know, obviously,
if Mickey didn't get the acclaim you might have expected, you can blame it on the local people. You would have thought that a town like Whitehaven with a museum would have some mention of this man in here. So you'll see in Whitehaven now two blue plaques to the people who formed the chemical company, with nothing to Mickey.